Okay, friends. So in the previous session, we have discussed about a balanced lobe detector. And in that case, that whatever the frequency variation means it is a frequency modulated wave, that is going to be converted into a amplitude variation or in a voltage variation. So if you remember that in a balanced detector, we have a frequency variation. It is converted into a amplitude variation and amplitude variation is given to a analog detector circuit and that is called a AM detector. And AM detector is producing the signal which is our modulating signal or it is our information signal. But here in this case, when the frequency variation is converted into a amplitude variation, for that we are using a through 3 tank circuit. One of the tank circuits is tuned at a carrier frequency fc, another tank circuit is tuned at fc plus delta f, means a higher than the carrier frequency, and one more tank circuit is there which is tuned for fc minus delta f. So here we require a 3 tank circuit. One tank circuit will be in the primary and the 2 tank circuit will be in the secondary. Now we know that fc, fc plus delta f and fc minus delta f, all these frequencies are very near to each other. So it is very difficult to tune the circuit. Here for the calibration purpose, when we are calibrating the circuit, then we have to tune a primary for the carrier frequency and then the secondary will be tuned for slightly higher than that. So here the tuning process is going to be very complicated, and if it is not tuned properly, then the output voltage or frequency modulated signal, it is going to be a distorted, your information is going to be a distorted. Now instead of that, we have one more technique where the tuning is almost a simpler. We have a tank circuit, but it is only tuned for a carrier frequency. And in this case, what we are doing, that whatever the frequency variation is there, this frequency variation is converted into a phase variation. This phase variation will produce a amplitude variation. And then we have a detector circuit, AM detector circuit, which will produce our information signal FM. So directly the frequency variation is not converted into a amplitude variation. In between we have this one more section which is called a phase variation. So as my frequency is going to be changing, then here there will be a change in the phase will be there, and this change in the phase will produce the change in the voltage. So advantage of this technique is that we require only one tuned circuit. Then this kind of technique which is known as a Foster series discriminator. Sometimes it is also known as a phase discriminator, or it is also known as a center tuned discriminator. So now let us see how we can convert a frequency into a phase, and then you are getting your original modulating signal. So here we have this circuit diagram, and in this circuit diagram you can see the D1 and D2, R3, C3 R4, C4. So this kind of a circuit already we have used in a balanced loop detector. So basically here, if we see that D1 and D2, this part is nothing but it is an envelope detector. D1 is also an envelope detector, D2 is also an envelope detector circuit. Then R3, C3, R4, C4, they are used for the filtering of the carrier frequency. Then if we see that whatever the upper part envelope detector is there, it is going to produce the voltage across the capacitor C3, and this voltage is called VA-O, and the voltage across this will produce a VB-O, okay? And my output voltage of the discriminator is VA-B, okay? And if we see the polarity, then for the polarity, when this diode D1 is in forward bias, then it will charge the capacitor in this way. So this will be a positive. When the D2 is in forward bias, it will charge the capacitor in this way. So this terminal is going to be a positive, and this is going to be a negative. Here also it is going to be a negative. And if we apply a Kirchhoff's law, then from this Kirchhoff's law, we can write the output voltage of the discriminator as VA-B is equal to VA-O minus VB-O. Correct? And here in a balanced detector, we know that when VB-O is greater than VB-O, the output voltage will be a positive. When this VB-O is more than the VB-O, then the output voltage of the discriminator is going to be a negative. Now let us see how this VB-O and the VB-O is going to be generated. Now if you look at this input of the discriminator circuit, we have a transformer. The primary of the transformer and the secondary of the transformer is there. Then in the primary, here if we see the capacitor C1 and L1, they are parallel, so they are forming a tuned circuit. This L1 and C1 is selected in such a way that the tuning frequency of this tank circuit will be a FC. So in the primary, tuning frequency is FC, resonance frequency is FC. Then in the secondary, the L2 and C2, they are in parallel, and here also they are selected in such a way that the tuning frequency will be AFC. So the primary as well as the secondary, both are tuned at the same frequency, and that is the carrier frequency. Okay. Now if you look at this capacitor CP, here, this capacitor, then this capacitor is nothing but it is a coupling capacitor, you can see. This is your coupling capacitor, okay? Which is coupled the primary to the secondary. Okay, now if you look at this, in the primary, the capacitor is connected at this point. The voltage across the primary is V1, or you can say this voltage is V12. That is the voltage across the primary. So here this point is connected to the ground, means the potential at this point will be a V12 will be there. Now this coupling capacitor, remember, here the coupling capacitor is selected in such a way that it will work as a short circuit for a frequency modulated wave, or it will be working as a short circuit for the frequency FC. Short circuit means the reactance of this capacitor will be a very small. So here this will work as a short circuit. So as a result, what will happen? Whatever the potential is here, the same potential will be at this point and that potential is V12. So the potential at this point will be a V12. Then this coupling capacitor is also used for blocking the DC, because whatever this primary of the transformer is there, it is a part of some tuned amplifier circuit. So if there will be some DC component is there, then it will be blocked by this coupling capacitor. But ultimately you should understand that here in the center tap transformer, whatever the center tap is there, it is not connected to ground, but the potential at this point, potential at the center is V12, and that is equal to your primary voltage. Okay, now to the center tap. The one inductor is connected, that is L3. It is also known as a radio frequency choke or the radio frequency coil. And this inductor L3, that reactance of the inductor L3 is very, very large. Here you can say L3 is a RFC and the reactance XL3 is very large. Okay, so between these two points, the inductor is connected. Now if you look at this inductor is connected to the capacitor C4 and the connected to a resistance R4. Here the value of the resistance R4 and R3, it is very large. But the reactance of the capacitor C4 is very, very small at a frequency of FC. Or for the radio frequency, this capacitor is here. This reactance of this capacitor is very small. So you can say it is working as a short circuit for this A frequency FC. So ultimately, this capacitor here, it is connected to this ground. Means whatever the potential is there, the same potential is appeared here. Now if you look at this, in the primary, this potential is connected to the ground, and with respect to this, we have this voltage V12. Correct? Now V12 is appeared here, and this terminal is also working as a ground because the reactance of the capacitor is very small. So whatever the voltage will be there across this inductor, this voltage you can say, let us say it is a V3, and this V3 will be equal to V12. Voltage across this capacitor will be equal to V12. Means my primary voltage is across a coil L3. Or in other words, you can see this circuit that I can draw in this way. This is my primary. We have this capacitor, and here this capacitor is connected to this CP, then it is connected to a inductor L3, then it is connected to a capacitor C4, and both are connected to the ground. Try to understand this. So this one is C1, this one is L1, L3, CP and C4. So voltage across this, here we have V12, correct? That you can see in the primary. V12 voltage is there. Now we have considered, here we have considered that the capacitor, this blocking this coupling capacitor, its reactance is very low compared to the reactance of the inductor. Same way, the reactance of the C4 is also a very low compared to the reactance of the inductor. So here actually you can understand in this way that reactance of the capacitor XL3 is too much greater than the reactance of this XP, as well as the reactance of the XL3 is too much greater than the reactance of X at 4. Means whatever the voltage is in the primary, now the same voltage will be also across the inductor L3. So here the V3 will be equal to V12, you can say. So my primary voltage is now across this inductor L3. Okay. Now if you see, then in the secondary we have a center tap. So whatever the voltage will be generated here, then the half of the voltage is given to the diode D1 and the half of the voltage is given to the diode D2. So let us say the voltage across this, voltage across this tank circuit is VAB. It is the induced voltage in the secondary. Then the voltage between these two points will be a one half VAB, and the voltage between these two points will be minus one half VAB. Why? Because it is a center tap, so there is a phase difference of 180 degree between the upper part of the voltage, upper part of the secondary of the transformer, to the lower part of the secondary of the transformer. So this both the voltage VAB are in opposite direction, 180 degree. That's why I am writing this a one half voltage, minus one half voltage. So now if you look at this voltage at this point, here, voltage at this point. Now, this is, you can consider this one as a ground. Remember, you can consider this as a ground because the reactance of the C4 is very small. So, the voltage given to the diode T1, that is the voltage between these two points, you can see. And that voltage will be equal to a V12 plus 1 half VAB. Remember, because here if you apply the Kirchhoff's law, then this V12 or V3 voltage will be there plus this voltage. So that is the voltage across, voltage given to the diode D1. You can say that voltage is a VD1. This voltage is VD1. So I will write that the VD1 voltage given to the upper part of the transformer, the voltage given to the diode D1, and that is a combination of a one half VAB plus a V3, and you can say instead of V3, we can write V12 plus 1 half VAB. Same way, here if you see the voltage given to the diode D2, then this voltage you have to measure with respect to ground. So if you see, then this voltage we call this as a VD2, correct? Voltage between this anode of the diode and this ground, it is a VD2. So this voltage we can write VD2, and that is equal to what? That this voltage V3 plus 1 half VAB. So here we can write minus 1 half VAB plus V3, and you can say it is a V12 minus 1 half VAB. Okay. So these are the voltage given to this a diode D1 and D2. So here if I want to write the output voltage, then we can say VA dash B dash is equal to a VD1 minus VD2. VDSO, remember, VDSO, that voltage is what? It is proportionally to the diode D1 voltage, and VBDSO is proportional to the diode D2 voltage. Okay, now whatever the expression I have mentioned here, these two expressions are there, then it is not an algebraic sum. When you say VD1 is equal to V1/2 plus 1/2 VAB, so this is not representing a algebraic sum, because here whatever the voltage V12 and the VAB is there, there is a phase difference between both the voltage. What is the V12? V12 is my primary voltage. Remember, V12 is a primary voltage, and VAB, that you can say 1/2 VAB, it is a secondary voltage. And here there is a phase difference between the primary voltage and the secondary voltage, and therefore you cannot have this kind of a algebraic sum. We have to take a vectorial addition. Now, with the help of a small mathematics, we can prove that when, here, we take the first case, when my input frequency is equal to a carrier frequency, means here, whatever the frequency we apply, if this my applied frequency is equal to a carrier frequency, then the phase difference between the primary voltage and the secondary voltage is going to be a 90 degree. Remember, primary voltage and secondary voltage means what? Here you can say the phase difference between the V12 and V1/2 VAB. So for that, the phase difference is 90 degree. Now, if my input frequency FC is greater than the carrier frequency FC, then the phase difference between the primary voltage and the secondary voltage here, in that case, this phase difference will be a less than 90 degree. And if you see the third one, when my input frequency is less than the carrier frequency, here the phase difference between the primary voltage and the secondary voltage will be a greater than 90 degree. Remember, mathematically we can prove this, but this mathematics is out of the scope of this lecture. That's why we are not discussing. So here you should understand that as the frequency is varying in the primary, then the phase difference between the primary voltage and the secondary voltage is going to change. If both the frequency are same, then the phase difference between the primary and the secondary voltage is 90 degree. Otherwise, it will be different than the 90 degree. So now, if you see, what is a vectorial addition? So if we take a first case, remember, then what is my first case? That my input frequency is equal to a carrier frequency. And in that case, what is the phase difference between the primary and the secondary voltage, it is a 90 degree. So here if I will draw a vector, then this is representing a primary voltage and this is representing my secondary voltage. Okay? Then in the secondary, one more voltage is there, that is the minus 1/2 voltage. So for that we can draw a vector like this. Okay. So this voltage is V12 and this voltage is 1/2 VAB. This is minus 1/2 VAB. Remember, because here in the secondary that there is a phase difference of a 180 degree between both the voltage. So we have a, so here if you see, then this phase difference is 90 degree. Okay? So now, what is the resultant voltage VD1? And resultant voltage means we have to take the vectorial addition. For the vectorial addition, already you know that if we make a here, so the addition of these two vectors will be a diagonal element. It will be a diagonal element like this. And same way, the addition of this V1 by 2 and minus 1 by 2 is this. Okay. And what is this voltage? This voltage is nothing but it is a VD1 voltage. And this voltage is a VD2 voltage. So when we take this vectorial addition, here in this case, the VD1 and VD2 both are same. So if the VD1 and VD2 both are same, it means the V-O will be equal to VV-O. Okay? So here if this voltage and if this voltage are same, so this voltage and this voltage will be also same. And as a result, if you see that VA-B-, that is my output voltage, it is going to be a zero. So when the input frequency is a carrier frequency, the output of the discriminator is going to be zero. Okay. Now let us see a second one. That when this input frequency is greater than the carrier frequency, correct? Then here again if I will draw a vector, then this is my V1 by 2, V12, and so this voltage is primary voltage V12. Now what about the secondary voltage, that is a V1/2 AB, and here you can see that the phase difference is less than 90 degree. It means that this voltage, or we can represent in this way, and this is nothing but 1/2 VEV, and this is a less than 90 degree. This angle is less than 90 degree. Now if I will draw a vector for the minus 1/2, then it will be like this, correct? So this is representing a minus 1/2 VAB. Now to find out what is the voltage given to the diode D1 and D2, we have to take the addition of these two vectors. And addition of these two vectors means, here I have to complete this, draw a parallelogram, complete this parallelogram, and you will get a resultant voltage. So the resultant of these two vectors will be this. Resultant of these two vectors will be this, and here you can see that this VD1 and this one is a VD2. So VD1 is greater than VD2. Remember, here we are discussing about what? A second case where the Fi is greater than Fc. So we can have a VD1 greater than VD2, means the V dash O is greater than VB dash O. So my output voltage A dash B dash is going to be a positive. So if you take the difference of this, this is greater than this, so the output voltage will be positive. Output of the discriminator is going to be a positive. Okay. Now let us see a third case. What is the third case? That my input frequency is less than the carrier frequency Fc. And in that case, the phase difference between the primary and the secondary voltage is more than 90 degrees. So if I will draw a vector, then this vector will be like this. Here, this is representing the primary voltage V12, then the secondary voltage, that phase difference is greater than 90 degrees, so we can draw in this way. Okay? This is representing a 1/2 VAB. This is minus 1/2 VAB, and this angle theta is, or you can see phi is greater than 90 degrees. And for the vector addition, if we complete this parallelogram, and if you see what is the resultant voltage, so one of the resultant voltages is, this is a VD1 and this one is VD2. Okay? So here we can say that the VD1 is less than VD2, VD1 is less than VD2, means my V dash O is less than VD dash O, so output voltage A dash B dash is going to be a negative. So here, in this way, as the frequency is changing in the primary, then the phase difference between the primary and the secondary voltage is changing. And that resultant voltage is given to the diode D1 and D2, which is going to produce a voltage V dash A, V A dash O, V B dash O. And if the input voltage V D1 is, or we can say, if my input frequency is greater than carrier frequency, then the VD1 voltage will be larger than the VD2 voltage, and the output voltage will be positive. If my input frequency is less than carrier frequency, then the VD1 voltage will be less than VD2 voltage, and as a result, the output voltage is going to be a negative. So in this way, the frequency vary, phase vary, and the output voltage is also going to vary. If you see the response, frequency response of the discriminator, response means on the x-axis we have the frequency, y-axis we have the output voltage, or you can say VA dash B dash is there. Now when this frequency is FC, then the output voltage is zero. That already we have seen. If the frequency is greater than the FC, then the output voltage is positive. This is positive voltage. Correct? And if this carrier, if this input frequency is less than carrier, then your output voltage is going to be a negative. Correct? If we join all this point, then you will get this type of the curve. This type of the curve. And this is almost a linear. Again, if we increase the frequency beyond this, then the curve will be like this. Here also the curve is like this. So it is a S curve or a phase discriminator. But the thing is that the here you can have a useful ring where the output voltage is linear with the frequency, and that is the advantage of the phase ring. This is known as the useful ring. So you have to operate your discriminator between these two frequencies. The output voltage is linearly with the frequency. What is the advantage? Advantage of the discriminator is that you have seen that we require only a one tuned circuit in primary and another tuned circuit in secondary, and both are tuned at the same frequency, that is the carrier frequency. So there is a simplicity in the circuit. What is the disadvantage? Disadvantage is there that suppose your frequency modulated wave contains some noise, or if there will be some amplitude variation will be there, then here we don't have a amplitude limited circuit. So your output voltage will also vary with the noise and you will get a distortion. That is only a disadvantage of this. And this disadvantage also we can overcome if we see the next detector circuit, and that is the ratio detector circuit. So in the next lecture, we will discuss about the working of a ratio detector.